Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Geo-Coat workshop. We will be recording the webinar, which would be made available before the end of this week. Please use the Q&A button for asking any questions. We will pick up the questions after the presentation has ended. So we'd like to start our webinar with our first speaker, Francesco Finicchia from TWI. He will be introducing the Geo-Coat project. Over to you, Francesco.
Thank you, Namrata. Good morning, everyone. Okay. So I'm going to start this this webinar this morning on the interesting project of how to enhance the production of geothermal energy. My presentation is mainly related to the Geo-Coat project, as I'm going to show in a second, and what we've done in this. It's more than 3 years now within the project, and why it is important for the overall geothermal community. So we'll be answering these two main questions in this presentation. Why are we interesting? Are we interested in coatings, first of all? And then I'm gonna present in a second stage the actual project itself. So just a quick recap for somebody that perhaps is not is from some other sector. So of course, who knows a lot about geothermal, please you can cover your ears. So this is basically how geothermal energy is produced. Very briefly, there are different methodologies, different type of power plants. So here I put the three examples: direct steam, double flash, and binary. Main differences are in the type of geothermal fluid that is employed, and of course the components of the power plant, how the geothermal fluid is processed. We go from direct steam, where the geothermal steam is actually used directly to produce energy, to a binary where the turbine or the energy generation item is not in contact at all with the geothermal fluid. So there is a heat exchanger, and the fluid generating energy is in a closed loop within the turbine. What it's important to understand for geothermal energy production is that variation in chemistry of the brines, it's very wide, not only due to geographical, not only geographically, so in different geographical areas around the world, but also within the same power plant. So you can see here, this is an example for the combined from LHAD and Ejavellir power plant in Iceland. And we can see how within the same cycle, chemical properties or thermodynamic properties of the fluid change considerably. And we can see here temperature, pressure, pH, carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, and chloride. So all these species contribute to different degradation mechanisms. And we kind of summarize it here into corrosion, erosion, and scaling. And they often act combined in the different components of the power plant. So this is a real issue. And we can see this through some examples here. This is a courtesy of on power. This is specifically for the steam turbine. This example I'm gonna show here in a second. And you can see here some erosion corrosion on the left picture. This is of our turbine diaphragm, erosion, blade trailing edge on the right-hand side. This is mainly purely of erosive nature, so there's no corrosion products in this case. So this is another type of damage mechanism. You can see in the casing itself, again, erosion corrosion likely can cause this features here within the casing, and they need to be addressed because they can lead to failure of the component. So why this is really important, and what do we need to do more You can see here, I just tried to summarize. So there's this one on the left is from 2018. Top 10 geothermal countries producing geothermal energy at the moment. So we know, you know, the US, Indonesia, Philippines, also others such as Iceland that are quickly ramping up. But important, most importantly, on the right-hand side, we can see how the International Energy Agency has laid down targets that should be reached. This is for the specific for the geothermal case, but there's also the others for other renewable energies. What we should be doing, how much energy we should be producing by 2030 to really be in a sustainable development scenario. And we can see how, here I have the numbers for 2024 and 2030, how we are not on track with geothermal. So something needs to be done. And what can we do here? There are several things that we can do. And there are projects addressing these three items here. One is expanding geothermal energy use. And the second is improving understanding of geothermal energy resources and how to employ them. And the third one is try and de-risk the capital cost or CapEx and OPEX as well. So operational cost of geothermal power plant operation. And this is what the Geo-Coat project focuses on, this third point. So getting a bit more in depth into the Geo-Coat project, what were the aims of the project? First of all, to develop new coatings to increase the lifetime of components of the geothermal power plant. As we showed, there's several areas that suffer from erosion, corrosion, and degradation, and they need to be addressed. But developing testing methodologies, because we as we figure out at the beginning of the project, a lot of the testing at the moment is not standardized, especially when one needs to produce, one needs to develop a new material from scratch. There is a lot of testing that needs to be done, and often one needs to use a lot of assumptions. So perform testing lab, a lab scale, hoping that the conditions that one uses are relevant to the end use of the coating. The third point, third aim was to develop the flow assurance simulator. So the idea was that once we develop these coatings, we have a model, this FAS, that is able to model the degradation occurring in a power plant. So a power plant operator has a model of his own power plant, can model where the corrosion erosion mechanisms will happen, will occur. And through the Geo-Coat project, we're able to tell the operator where to apply the coatings, in which locations to maximize, you know, the cost. Of course, this coatings comes at a cost, as we'll see later. And this is actually the fourth point, the third aim, to calculate the economical and environmental impact. The aim of the project was to reduce CapEx and OPEX, as I already said, but also to reduce the environmental impact of energy production. And so who we are 11 partners from four main countries: Iceland, United Kingdom, Romania, and Norway. I'm not going to go into depth. Some of these companies will present themselves later in the next presentations. I work in TWI. We are coordinating the project, so I sit in the United Kingdom. So in terms of work package organization for the project, we had 11 work packages. Two of them, of course, the top ones, dissemination and management. But in terms of technical work packages, we have first of all a first work package where we define the environment and the scope of the project, and then we get into lab-based coating down selection, so coating deposition and testing in a lab scale. And work package 6 and 8, which are this in purple, we had simulated and field test analysis. The idea was to run them in parallel. Of course, that's quite challenging. And work package 7, we have a definition of the flow assurance simulator, so the numerical framework of the project. And in work package 9, we deal with economical and environmental impact assessment. Now, work package 1, 8, 7, and 9 are going to be covered in this meeting. As we see today, we are here with towards the end of the project. We finish in May. So basically we are analyzing the last results from work package 8 at the moment, the field tests. We're gonna hear a bit later from my colleague Dagur from the University of Iceland. Okay, so what have we done practically in the project? We had several deposition techniques here in red: electrospark deposition, laser metal deposition, high velocity oxy-fuel spray, hot isostatic pressing, electrolyzed plating, different materials processed through these techniques, from high entropy alloys, Cermets, MMCs, so metal matrix composites, and duplex coatings that corresponds to different substrates in blue and components. So the substrates were defined according to the component that we're targeting for that specific substrate. And you can see here we're targeting pipes and casings, valves and turbine, pump impellers, and heat exchangers. And of course, we haven't used all the deposition techniques and materials for all of these, but we try and target most likely solutions, the solutions that most likely would address the issue there. Just some pictures here. I'm not gonna go into a great deal of detail in this presentation. It's an introductory presentation. But you can see here some laser metal deposited samples on top left. These are rods used for flow through exposure test, some flat coupons of a Cermet deposited through HVOF. Again, it's all for exposure tests. And here, nickel phosphorus PTFE on the bottom right-hand side. So for U-band test in work package 8 in the field. Some metal matrix composites discs used for erosion corrosion, again, at the end of the project in the field tests. And here also we addressed, just wanted to mention that we addressed also welding of coated components, because that's an important part in the final application of such a technology. And we can see here a welded laser metal deposited high entropy alloy coupon. So this is also part of the work we've done here. So these were the systems that we down-selected originally from in a first stage of the project. We had the first stage of down selection in work package 5, so around the middle of the project. And we had two systems selected that we then took into testing work package 6 and 8, as I said, simulated geothermal conditions and field tests. And these are the two systems that we use. So generally for the first four substrates and applications, we have a Cermet and a laser metal deposit, HVOF Cermet, and a laser metal deposited high entropy alloy coating, two MMCs for the pump impellers, and two electrolyzed plated nickel phosphorus coatings. I tried to summarize most of the results that we, most of the tests that we did here from work package 6 onwards. So we cannot see here all the tests that we did in electrochemistry at the beginning of the project. So the ones in work package 2, 3, and 4, where we targeted one specific performance at a time. Here we can see flow through reactors done at the University of Iceland. So we have a flowing fluid simulating the geothermal brine, static autoclave test here, TWI, erosion corrosion, the WIA group, and stress corrosion cracking. So these samples were placed in the static autoclave here, TWI. And then we move into work package 8, where we have different tests. So we can see here aerated pressure vessel, erosion corrosion test. If you remember those discs I showed a minute ago, the MMC discs were placed in this setup. An internally cladded and welded pipe. It is one of the last stage of testing in the project. At the beginning of work package 8, we have this exposure in the wellhead. So this equipment was placed with all these coupons within the wellhead to test, if you remember those square coupons I just showed of HUF Cermets, and heat exchanger pipe testing for the electrolyzed plated nickel phosphorus coatings that we are currently running. We're just about to to stop if I'm not wrong. Yeah, just some results, some pictures. I'm not gonna go into detail again, but you can see on the left hand side from Work Package 6, some coupons tested, laser metal deposited on the left hand side, and HVS Cermet. A lot of learning from these tests. There were manufacturing cracking that we identified. There were post-test cracking, so developed during the test, that we have identified. Development of different types of corrosion products depending on the system. So we have a lot of material that we're currently analyzing, but I just wanted to give a brief idea of where we are heading. So preliminary from Work Package 6, we have identified these systems as the final systems that we want to select as part of the Geo-Coat project. So the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy containing molybdenum for the first four substrates and applications, so pipes and casing, valves and turbine. And a titanium 6-4, so grade 5, a pump impeller MMC for the pump impellers containing titanium diboride, and a low phosphorus containing nickel phosphorus PTFE coating for the heat exchangers. And that concludes my presentation. So thank you for listening.
Thank you, Francesco. We have one question regarding why have you only considered nickel phosphorus coatings for heat exchangers and not for other application? Is this about performance or the cost?
That is a good question. Thanks for asking. Of course, we had to identify at the beginning of the project a good framework to work on. We couldn't target too many applications. We have selected the heat exchanger because scaling, it's a specific issue there, and we did know from literature that of course PTFE, having low energy material, low surface energy material, will help in mitigating scaling. So talking about mineral scaling in the heat exchanger, and therefore we, as a low tier project, we decided to start from this as an application. But this doesn't stop us, of course, from extending the use later on to different components.
Thank you. Thank you, Francesco. We have another question. In which enthalpy segment the polymeric coating can be applied?
Oh, that's a good question. So we didn't target specifically polymeric coatings in the project. We're not looking into that. There are other projects where we're looking into this. Of course, polymeric coatings can be applied where the temperatures are, temperatures and also mechanical damage at an extent is not excessive. Of course, we're looking at the wellhead, the temperatures are very high. So if one wants to select a polymeric coating, needs to be wary of that. We did test some systems as part of this project, but trying to to coat. If you remember those coupons that I showed in a second ago, those are some epoxy-based systems to cover the edges of the coating. We didn't target them specifically for the project, but there's a lot of studies out there in literature, also for steam turbine. For several applications, it's a big topic for pipelines. So there are several locations, low temperature, low mechanical damage generally. But yeah, it was not part of the project, unfortunately.
Thanks, Francesco. We have another one for you. So what coating did you apply for 630SS? Are there any results about the improvements regarding the coated 630SS?
Yes, so let me share my screen quickly. So as I said, so we tested different systems. Eventually the system that we we ended up selecting was this laser metal deposited system, also for this case that you're mentioning. Now the project was very low TRL, so we tried to end up to TRL 5. So I ended up selecting the same system for different substrates. We know that the system that we selected is very well resistant to corrosion and erosion. We do have a lot of results. Of course, this, I cannot share it here in this in my presentation itself. I guess we'll see some more results in the next presentations from the other partners. So I guess if you don't mind waiting for the other presentations, you might see some more information about this later on. Otherwise, I'm able to share, if you don't find what you're looking for in this presentation, please get in touch with us and we'll supply more information after this webinar.
Okay, thanks, Francesco. In the interest of the time, if we can move on to the next presentation from Innovation Center Iceland. So Dagur, if you can bring your screen up.
Yes.
So Dagur will be presenting about the in-situ durability testing of the Geo-Coat developed coatings. So Dagur is a project manager working at the Innovation Center Iceland, and he will be showcasing some of the results from the Geo-Coat. Over to you, Dagur.
Thank you, Namrata. Today, I'll be talking about the in-situ durability testing that we did to validate the Geo-Coat developed coatings in an actual geothermal environment. I will also lightly discuss some of the main results from those tests. I'll start with this image from maybe many of you have heard. We had a small reminder from Mother Earth about the power and energy which dwells underneath the surface of our planet. This is a gentle and small reminder here in Iceland and not a big eruption, so we should not be worried, but there are some many amazing pictures to be seen. So, just as a quick introduction, Francesco already went through most of this already. The different types of coatings and materials developed, and which were already optimized throughout the earlier stages of the project. But to down select then the final coatings for their applications, both laboratory and in situ corrosion and erosion performance tests were conducted. And a little bit about laboratory and in situ tests. So laboratory testing, which was mainly performed by TWI and University of Iceland, is of course in, you're able to control these tests more easily than the so-called in situ tests, and thus are able to conclude more on the effect of single chemical species, and as well to accelerate the corrosion effect more easily. So in a way it can be very good when working on specifically targeting specific chemical species or specific parameters when it comes to corrosion and erosion and such. But in situ testing, in situ meaning on site, when translated directly from Latin, is in real environment or on site. And for us, this means a real geothermal environment that had, let's say, the power plant where all of our in situ testings took place. They can often be less expensive than the laboratory testing, especially when you have a good cooperation with the power plant operator, ON Power, which has been a great partner in this project. But then again, the environment can be more complex, which can lead to more difficult analysis, which sometimes can be more inconclusive in comparison to the laboratory testing. There's a large table that gives you an overview of the material systems that were developed and tested. Francesco already briefly discussed this, so I won't go into detail, but you can see, as you can see, we targeted six different kinds of applications where we have a state-of-art material, which we use to compare the coatings and materials developed to see how we are able to improve them. And now to the tests themselves. During the course of the project, we did five different types of in-situ testing at Hellisheiði power plant, which used, and we had various different testing conditions and simulated actual different service environments that components within the power plant experience. And on the right there, you can see the names of the five different tests, which Francesco also briefly mentioned. The first being the wellhead test, where all coatings and materials developed were tested alongside their state-of-art substrates in an actual wellhead at Hellisheiði power plant. Second is the aerated pressure vessel testing, where we mixed turbine steam with ambient air to create quite corrosive conditions. Then we have the erosion corrosion testing, where we flashed geothermal fluid at high velocities onto test plates to induce erosion corrosion. And there we tested substrate groups 2 to 5. And then the last two are a bit more specific for their applications. So we have the heat exchanger pipe testing, where we tested the electroless nickel plated coating and compared them to three state-of-art substrates in conditions that were designed to simulate what heat exchanger tubes experience. And then the final test is the so-called welded coated pipe section testing, where we internally coated a 168 millimeter pipe, carbon steel pipe, with the final down selected coating from substrate group 1, which is for the pipe and casing, and tested it. And now to the specific tests, first being the wellhead test. And on the right images there, you can see the sample rack, which held various types of coupons, U-bend samples, welded sample as well, which was then inserted into the wellhead. You can see there on the top. And on the right, the bottom right, you can see how the sample rack looked after testing. And basically, these are two long bars fastened to a circular pressure plate. And we use threaded rods and ceramic shoulder bushings to hold the coupons in place. And all coating systems and state-of-art substrates were tested there in well 23 at Hellisheiði power plant. So here on the bottom left, you can see the pressure plate, which was at the top of the long bars, which I showed you earlier. Well, the samples were exposed inside well 23 for 3 months. Temperatures were around 200 degrees, pressure about 14 bars. And you can see the fluid sampling there on the right. We have corrosive gases such as CO2, H2S, along with other species such as chloride, natrium, and sulfur-based species such as SO4 and SO2. And now to some of the analysis. We had quite a lot of various coupons and samples tested. And for the microstructural samples, which were the most numerous, we analyzed them cross-sectionally and we did surface analysis using SEM, EDS, optical microscopy. we had some weight loss measurement samples of the state of art substrates, and then we had some tribological and mechanical samples as well. And here on the right, you can see some cross section SEM images of the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2 there on top. In the middle, you have the high velocity oxyfuel Cermets alloy 2, both of these being deposited on substrate 1, carbon steel. And then on the bottom, you have the A470, which is often used in turbine rotors. Well, the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2 remained quite unaffected by the exposure and resisted the environment quite well. The holes there, the small voids you can see in the coating are from manufacturing, where you have gas trapped within the solidifying metal. Now for the high velocity oxyfuel Cermets coating, it performed quite well and resisted the environment, although we had some permeation and penetration of corrosive species, maybe 30 to 50 micrometer depth into the coating. What you can see there at the coating substrate interface is some aluminum particles that are the result of sandblasting the carbon steel surface prior to deposition. And then for the A470 material, we had in most areas uniform corrosion. You can see the uniform corrosion layer on top of the surface of the material with deposits there on top. And as you can see there as well, we have some pits there forming underneath the corrosion layer. And now for the second test, the aerated pressure vessel test. You can see on the right picture a bill of materials image there, or schematic. The equipment uses separated steam from the power plant, so the same steam as flows through the turbines. And as the steam flows into the pressure vessel, an ejector is used to draw in ambient air into the equipment to form quite corrosive environment within the vessel. And the idea behind the test originally came from Simon Dirkulusson at Owen Power. This was something that we did not plan at the beginning of the project, but the idea was great. So we went ahead and designed and constructed this equipment and put it in use. And this simulates the axial seal system suction path in geothermal power plants, which often corrodes quite heavily. The similar as in the wellhead test, the samples were exposed for 3 months. The temperatures there within the equipment was 90 degrees, pressure about 1 bar, and the amount of air was around 500 liters per kilo. As you can see there on the right, we had a low pH of around 4.9, along with some minor amounts of species such as chlorine, fluorine, and SO4. Now to some of the analysis. We only tested microstructural samples inside the equipment. So we did some SEM, EDS, and optical microscopy. And on the top there, you can see, on the top right, you can see the high velocity oxyfuel, Cermets alloy 2. And on the bottom is the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2, the same coatings as I showed you earlier, although in reverse order. Oh well. The reddish color there on the samples is rust coming from, it's leaking from the threaded rod and the ceramic shoulder bushing. So it's not coming from the coatings themselves. But on the SEM image there, for the high velocity oxyfuel Cermets alloy 2, we can see some horizontal cracking, which initiates in the nickel chromium phase of the coating. This these cracks, they tend to, within this specific environment, they travel horizontally and result in some loss of material for the coating, which does not perform too well in the aerated environment. But meanwhile, the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2 performs very well and is mostly not affected by the exposure. You can see there on the image some of the manufacturing cracks which Francesco mentioned. You have these small cracks there close to the surface of the coating, although these cracks did not affect the performance of the coating in this environment. And now to the third test performed, which is the erosion corrosion testing. You can see on the top right a assembly image of a single test unit which tests one sample at a time. And then below you can see we assemble six of these test units together. So we're able to test six disc-like samples at a time. And this equipment uses a high temperature geothermal fluid coming from a wellhead and flashes the fluid onto a test plate through a small nozzle. And this equipment was originally designed and made by Vielvik in Iceland. And the high velocity of the fluid and particles within it induce erosion corrosion on the samples. And here we tested Geo-Coat coatings intended for turbine components and pump impellers, along with their respective state-of-art materials. And these are these erosion corrosion effects, which Francesco already showed you a bit in his previous talk. The samples were tested for 2 months at a time, and the well used was well 56 at the Tetlesia power plant. Temperature at the wellhead are about 170 degrees, and we have pressures of about 14.5 bars. And the pH of the fluid is a little bit over 9. We have many interesting species within the fluid, some minor amounts of gold and silver, but most notably quite a bit of silica. We have chlorine and also some gases such as H2S and CO2, although they are not listed there. And now to some of the analysis. We mainly did the cross-sectional and surface analysis along with some other more macro analysis as well. And here we have the substrate 2 samples. So we have the same coatings which I showed you previously, but in this case, they are deposited on stainless steel. And on the bottom left, you can see the state of our substrate 630 stainless steel, which experienced some erosion corrosion of the surface during test. And you can see there on the top image, a relatively large piece of the material engulfed in silica scaling, which adhered to the top surface of the sample. And additionally, we saw some 5 to 10 micron corrosion layer on parts of the area analyzed. Now for the high velocity oxyfuel Cermets alloy 2, the coating performed decently. There was some erosion and corrosion of the surface. We noticed some carbide detachment and some loss of material, but not to a great extent. But meanwhile, for the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2, the coating remained quite unaffected by the exposure, and we were quite happy with the results. And now for the fourth test, which is a bit more specific. This is the heat exchanger pipe testing equipment, And you can see an assembly picture there on the right. It's in Icelandic, apologies. But this equipment uses separator water coming from Hellisheiði power plant, which is already oversaturated with silica. And this fluid flows into the four pipes there at the bottom of this, you could say, steel bathtub, which you can see on the image there. The fluid flows inside the pipes, and in the bathtub itself, as you could say, we have cold water circulating in and out. So we cool down the already oversaturated separator water inside the pipes in order to precipitate silica internally in the pipes. And thus we are able to assess the material's resistance to scaling accumulation in conditions similar to what heat exchanger pipes experience. And what we tested there, and we are working on analyzing, are four different pipes. So we have the electroless nickel plated coated carbon steel pipe. And then we have three state-of-art substrates, 254 SMO, 316L, and titanium grade 2. And on the bottom left there, you can see the actual equipment being assembled. Well, the pipes were tested for 100 days. The inlet temperature of the separator water is 172 degrees and the outlet was about 90 degrees. We have around 80 degree Celsius temperature drop within the pipes, and pressure of the fluid was around 8 bars. And as you can see there, we have plenty of silicon oxide, 676 parts per million. pH little a bit below 9, and then we have also some corrosive species, H2S, CO2, and chlorine. On the right there, you can see this is a carbon steel pipe, which was tested preliminary when we were getting ourselves more familiarized with the equipment and taking steps to improve it. And you can see it's been cut up there, and the black scaling on the internal of the pipe is silica, and the white spots as well. Although these are silicas which precipitate under different conditions, we are mostly interested in the black silica there. So for the analysis, we will do some cross-sectional surface analysis and some weight gain measurements as well to better quantify the amount of silica accumulation. And as I said, we did some preliminary carbon steel results, and you can see myself there preparing some acid cleaning of the external diameter of one of the pipes there. And based on the scruffy beard and unkempt hair, you can tell that this is during the COVID lockdowns here in Iceland. Well, what we noticed during the preliminary test, we had some considerable external corrosion due to oxygen present in the cooling water, but that's on the external of the pipes. But on the inside, we have a fairly even distribution of silica in terms of weight, which is in line with its solubility in water. And now to the last test, we have the welded coated pipe section testing. Not the best name, but I take responsibility for that. Here we have two 168 millimeter pipe sections internally coated. The pipe being manufactured from S235JR carbon steel. One pipe was internally coated with the laser metal deposited high entropy alloy 2, and the other with an Inconel 625 coating. Then we butt welded these together using Inconel 625 feather wire, This was all done at TWI. Then we tested this for 2 months in an aerated production water at Hellisheiði power plant at 90 degrees and 3 bars. These are somewhat similar conditions as what the aerated pressure vessel gives us. We haven't done the analysis yet. We're still working on it, or we will start soon. And we will do some cross-sectional and surface analysis. And the weld itself will be then analyzed by TWI, the Welding Institute in Britain. And now to summarize. So to thoroughly assess the properties and qualities of multiple developed materials, a significant amount of testing is required. And in Geo-Coat, we implemented both laboratory and in-situ testing. We already spoke about some laboratory testing and results when our colleague Sigrun Anna Karlsdóttir at the University of Iceland did a webinar, Geo-Coat webinar previously. But we, for the in-situ tests, we performed 5 experiments, the wellhead test, the aerated pressure vessel test, erosion corrosion testing and heat exchanger pipe testing, as well as the last one, the welded coated pipe section testing. And the samples acquired from these tests were analyzed using various methods. The performance of most developed materials, they differ in different exposure conditions, and some are more suitable for certain environments than compared to others, which is something that we would have expected. But one particular coating system seems to perform very well across a range of different conditions. And this is the laser metal deposited high entropy level 2, and especially so when deposited on stainless steel substrate. And this is as well supported by the laboratory results already discussed by Sigrun, as I mentioned. But as you may be noticed, I did not go in depth into analysis and results, but further durability performance details of the Geo-Coat developed coatings in in-situ environment will be published in some upcoming papers. So stay tuned. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dagur, for an interesting presentation. So we have one question for you. Why silica it is expected after flash process and not before, for instance, at wellhead?
Sorry, why?
Why silica it is expected after flash process and not before, for instance, at wellhead?
I believe, well, this might be better answered by some of our partners at ON. But if I understand correctly, this has a lot to do with the solubility of the silica and lowering of temperature. And the silica is expected to precipitate more at lower temperatures. And so as it travels through the geothermal power plant, we are always more and more endangered by the precipitation as the solubility decreases.
Okay, thank you. So moving, thank you for your presentation, Dagur. So moving on to our next speaker from Flowfis, which is Per. So Per would be presenting on some of the flow assurance simulation, simulator stuff that was carried out as part of the Geo-Coat project. So Per, would you like to share your screen now?
Hello, everyone. I'll try to share my screen here. There. Yes. So thank you, Namrata. My name is Per Kjellgren, and I am based in a company called Flowfis. We are based in Norway, and I will talk a little bit about the Geo-Coat geothermal flow assurance simulator. So what is flow assurance? Flow assurance comes very much from the oil and gas industry. And what it really means is dynamic simulations of multi-phase flows and pipe networks. So that means that we can go to single phase and multi-phase with different flow regimes like stratified, wavy bubbly, slug flow, and so on. We also typically, in oil and gas industry, we typically also look at operational procedures. So that means startup and shutdown, inhibitor injection, cleaning procedures, such as pigging, for example. And we want to look at things like solid deposits, so hydrates, scales, wax, and also integrity, like corrosion, erosion, vibrations, a fluid acoustic phenomenon called singing, for example. The term itself was coined by Petrobras, and it means literally guarantee of flow. It is considered a key technology in the oil and gas industry, and it won an award as the best Norwegian invention since 1980, a few years ago. So why is this important for the Geo-Coat project? Well, with a flow assurance simulator, we can provide the correct operating conditions in time and space for whatever models we want to use to predict corrosion, erosion, and scaling. So for example, temperature, shear stresses, flow speeds, fluid composition, concentrations, and so on. And in addition to this, we can also use this one to provide input for cost and environmental impacts. So for example, if we're gonna make a system, what kind of pressure drops will we have, and so on, and what kind of erosion rates might we have. Now, in the oil and gas industry, there are already rather well-developed flow assurance simulators, and the market leader is Olga, and the number two is Leda Flow. However, for these simulators, well, in general, for any kind of oil and gas industry flow assurance simulators, it is not possible to just take it as it is and apply it on geothermal conditions unless it is tuned and modified for geothermal applications. That means, for example, geochemistry, but not only that, because flow assurance calculations with their networks when things happening, a valve opening, a pigging being performed or anything like that, it creates a lot of numerical instabilities. So when you develop those solvers, you kind of need to tune it towards relevant applications. So it has a lot of, so it's kind of important to tailor-made this flow assurance simulator for geothermal conditions. And another reason why we didn't use that in this project is also because we want to open up for integration with the flow assurance simulator with other softwares, for example, software for estimating cost and environmental impacts. So we took the decision to develop a new geothermal flow assurance simulator in this project. I should say that in FlowFIS, we are developing various different multiphysics software. Typically, they're always finite element based. We do it in 1D, 2D, 3D, and we include multiphysics. So we're looking at fluid structures, heat transfer, acoustics, and also flow assurance. In terms of graphics, for the flow assurance, which are 1D, we have a native GUI under development, and we're continuously adding features there. For 2D and 3D, we typically couple it to other software for the graphics, for the pre and post processing, so ANSYS or Gmesh. We also often use optimization, and we couple it to Dakota. We also often, for the geochemistry, we couple it to FreeQC. there are lots of different features in this flow assurance simulator. And I should say that it is under development and supported by 7 different projects. So 5 of those are Horizon 2020 projects, and they're listed here: SmartRig, Geo-Coat, GeoDrill, GeoSmart, GeoPro, and also a Eurostars project and another project from a Norwegian Research Council that is about to start soon. There's a variety of options here. So single phase, two phase, steady state, time dependent, incompressible, compressible, Newtonian, non-Newtonian, and so on. We have a bunch of different device models in it. So with that, I mean models for like turbines and pumps and separators, heat exchangers, and so on. But it can also be, it's typically 0D models, but it can also be 1D models, like, for example, an annulus, or, for example, a heat storage that we have. So it's not only 0D, but also 1D models. And we have models for corrosion, erosion, and scaling, and also fluid structure interaction under development. Yes, so a lot of things going in there. Single and two-phase flow, the solver is based on conservation equations, a conservation of mass, momentum, energy. Because we also can do networks, we also need to conserve energy and mass at the junction nodes. We, for two-phase flows, we currently use homogeneous or drift flux models, but more is under development. For non-Newtonian fluids, we typically use Herschel-Balkley. Fluid properties, we can put in constant properties, we can put in semi-empirical equations, basically from steam relations. And we also have for non-Newtonian fluids like the Herschel-Balkley, which is convenient for drilling mud. We can also put in general PVT tables, and we have software tools for generating PVT tables as well from FreeQC. One advantage with using a PVT table rather than actually doing the geochemical calculations is because it's typically a lot faster and a lot more stable. But we also have the coupling with a FreeQC reaction module. So we can do the geochemical calculations in each cell throughout the whole network at each timestamp. I should mention that in two of the projects, of the other projects we have, we're also developing improved geofluid models that also are looking more in detail into reaction kinetics and also looking more into things like supercritical flows and so on. That's taking place in the projects, GeoPro and GeoSmart, both of them Horizon 2020 projects. For the corrosion, we are currently mainly using a NORSOC model. This one is really for the oil and gas industry. It assumes carbon steel, it assumes CO2 rather than, for example, H2S. But nevertheless, it is a model that is often used in the oil and gas industry in flow assurance context. So we have put that one in here. And then for the setup is made, so we could put in other models also, and that will probably happen in the future. If we have general data, we can also use meta models. So we use combination of design of experiments plus meta model using the Dakota code. And by doing that, we can take data from experiments. We can take data from, for example, FreeCorp, which is what we have been using. And if we have coated surfaces, like in the Geo-Coat, we can also use that to make models. For the erosion, we're using a DNV erosion model for piping systems. In practice, at least with this model, we will only see large erosion rates when we have bends. If we would have a coated surface, we do not have any model for it, but we can use the same approach as up here. So we use meta models for that. scaling models. We have a basic model based on saturation indices. So the saturation indices we develop as a function of space and time in the network, and we can use that to make predictions for scaling. Yes, for the GUI. So this is under development, but we can model networks, and we can put in a rather complex network and solve for that. And we also have a drilling module, so we can look at drilling operations. And that is from the Horizon 2020 GeoDrill project. This user interface, it is in addition to using it as a graphical user interface, we also can do input-output through input files. And we also use a macro language for that, so that we can put rather complex models up and also have them well documented. In case the user forget how the commands work or want to learn other things, we have help functions, and it goes to online manual. If we look at results, here are just, very simple results from a schematic case. We are down in the well here, we're going topside here. We have a pump there, and here we have a heat exchanger. It could also really be a turbine, so pressure loss plus heat loss, and then it goes down again. So we can, of course, calculate the pressure, we can calculate the temperature, can calculate things like gas-liquid fractions, we can calculate things like mixture density. And of course, if we look at the effects of this, we can look at corrosion rates. So we can see the distribution of the corrosion rates at different locations in the system. We can look at things like saturation indices, in this case for silica. We can look at erosion. Erosion is, of course, rather dependent on velocity, so that might also be of interest. Here we see an example of where we have combined this simulator with ANSYS graphics. So it's like a plugin in ANSYS, and we have plotted here for two-phase flow coming in here, going to a separator. Here we have a turbine, we have a heat exchanger. And it goes in here, and we can look at the total mass flow on the top here. In the bottom here, we look at the steam and, the gas mass fraction. And we can look at mixture densities. We can look at erosion rates here also. Again, this is with the DNV model. And here we have a corrosion rates again with the NORSOC model. I'd also like to show examples of how we can use the simulator also for control. So this is from another project, but it's just to show how we in that project use the controllers. So we have, for example, PID controllers. So typically, if we want to control a system, we typically would like to control the valves. We could also control the pumps, but the valves are faster. So in this case, we have the system here, and here we have simulations. We have an intermittent heat source here, heat exchanger, and then we have an end user heat load. And in the first case, we focus on keeping the end user temperature constant. In the second case, we focus on keeping the end user heat extraction constant. So in this case, it takes a few cycles to reach a constant level. So this is just an example, but we could of course also use it for a geothermal setting. We haven't tested that yet though with the controls, but we could use it in, you know, for looking at inhibitory injection and things like that. And then in that case, we would see the distribution along the pipelines. So to summarize, we have developed a new transient multiphase flow assurance simulator, which provides operating conditions in time and space for improved prediction of corrosion, erosion, and scaling. It is focused on geothermal power plants. So we couple it with geochemistry, more specifically the free QC. We have some initial models for corrosion, erosion, and scaling, and we'll probably try to add more models in the future. And the whole point with this flow assurance simulator in this project is that it provides guidance for where to apply the coatings, which locations is this most needed, and also how much is it needed, how severe is the need for it. This is a software tool that is under development in multiple projects. So it is under rapid development, and we are adding more features almost every day. So that's all I had to say. Thank you for your thank you for listening and for your time.
Thank you, Per. We have quite a few questions for you. So the first question: is it possible to use down the hole SAT software to predict geothermal species scaling in geothermal wells?
We should be able to do that, yes. I should say I am not certain we will make it work that well with the free QC software. However, we are developing new relations for the geofluids in the, especially in the GeoPro project. And one of the hopes is that we will be able to look at the scaling also in the downhole.
Thank you. There's another question. When the software will be available for users to run the different modules?
We are planning to release a version by the end of the year. It might be a beta version, but we are very happy to interact with anyone who is interested in looking more into what this software can do. And I think we will be ready to start providing beta versions for you in that case sometime during the autumn.
A follow-up question on this: which modules are available now?
Right now, there is no module that is available because we are still developing it. But we will have a beta version of it so that you can use perhaps not the drilling module, but everything else should be available during the autumn.
Thank you. Then we have another question. Could you explain why is there a need for new flow assurance solver than Olga ladder flow? Example, high water cut oil wells, high temperature and two phase production systems also do exist in oil and gas. Where are the gaps?
Okay, so the operating conditions for a geothermal well and power plant is different than from the oil and gas situation. And I should say that I have in the past been working, for example, with the development of LEDA flow. And when you do those simulators, you really need to tune them and test them towards systems that are similar to the systems that you actually will simulate. So if you take flow assurance simulator from oil and gas, where the main focus is on offshore oil fields, and where things like, for example, hydrate is very important, And then you take it to a situation where you have geothermal, where you have a power plant, you have a different fluid composition, you would typically have higher temperatures. You really need to tune it towards that to use it efficiently. In addition to that, the oil and gas flow assurance simulators, they are typically not connected to geochemistry modules. I think they might have been in some research projects, perhaps, but I don't think it is commercially available. If it is, please let me know.
Okay, another question for you. Did you calibrate the model with on-site measurements?
We haven't gotten to that point yet. So in this project, it's mainly been trying to get the software up and running, put in the main functionality. However, in one of the other projects that we have, GeoSmart, the intention is to do rather complex system there with lots of different devices and many different pipe branches. And there we will try to look more into details and compare with reality. In this one, we have done some comparison, but not at all that much yet.
Okay. Thank you, Per. Thank you so much for your presentation. And our next speaker is Mohammed Chaudhry from TVS. So Mohammed will be presenting on the environmental footprint results with and without a Geo-Coat technology. Mohammed, can you please share your screen?
Yes. Right. Hello, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. So hello, everyone. First, I would like to introduce myself. My name is M.A. Hai Chaudhary. And a brief introduction about me. Actually, I graduated from University of Dhaka, Bangladesh, where boson particle born, and also did a PhD from Brunel University, UK. And before I joined Technovative Solutions based in Manchester, UK, I worked for two universities in UK. University of Manchester and Brunel University. And I also worked for two other universities in Bangladesh, Shahjalal University and Bouet. And now I'm working for TBS based in Manchester, UK. So let's move on to the webinar. Welcome everyone. So you can see my title page. This is about the environmental footprint results with and without adoption of Geo-Coat technology components in a geothermal power plant. So the results, what I found from the, you know, the Geo-Coat project, what from the work package 9 mainly. So what are the contents of this project? So first I introduce the what I intend to do. What would be the output of the topic this is. And then second section is talking about the LCA method, how we evaluate the environmental footprint. This is what we normally do, the ISO LCA standard method, what we call life cycle assessment. So we talk about this one a little bit more to understand how we evaluate the environmental footprints of the Geo-Coat technology components. And in the very first sections, we also introduce what do you mean by the Geo-Coat technology components and what is the objective of our study. And in the next third sections, we talk about how we modeling the Geo-Coat materials and also SO materials and how we get the life cycle impact assessment results, what I mean by environmental impacts or environmental footprints of those materials. So, and using these results to the power plant. So I so in this case, we are considering a power plant Icelandic perspective. So here we are employing our Geo-Coat technology in different geothermal components in the in that power plant. And then we analyze the environmental impacts with and without adoption of these Geo-Coat technology components. What I mean by without adoption of Geo-Coat technology means that we considering with Geo-Coat proposed SO materials and also recommended SO materials. You will see later, I think. And then finally, we conclude our results. And then we just talk about the introductions a little bit. So you already familiar from the very first webinar talk is about the what is the intention of this Geo-Coat you know that EU Horizon 2020 project. And its excellence lies in the concept of actually developing the synthesis coating for geothermal components to combat against the corrosion, erosion, and scaling damages. So this is the main idea. So if we develop a Geo-Coat technology for different components, what we call if we consider say coated carbon steel, you know, the Geo-Coat technology coated carbon steel material, what we call the Geo-Coat technology components. And then we can also, so once we understand the Geo-Coat technology components, this is mean by, you know, that we just considering as either pipes components or well casing components or other turbine components. And if we consider that, okay, these components are made of this state-of-art materials or can be made of recommended state-of-art materials. So that's why environmental, you can see my, right, okay. Right, so environmental impacts. So we need to be know, so what would be the environmental impacts of the Geo-Coat technology components and the SO material components. So we can compare it. So if we apply our Geo-Coat technology to the geothermal components, are you increasing the environmental footprint more or less? That's why our intention is to be studied this one. That's why our main objective is to be finding out the, evaluating the environmental footprints, the best candidate of the Geo-Coat technologies, what we have deduced, I mean, you know, that derived from various results from the Geo-Coat projects. So we identified, okay, this is the best candidate of Geo-Coat technology for turbine component. This one is the best for the pipes and casing and other components, right? And also we can comparing this environmental footprint results of this Geo-Coat technologies with you know, the Geo-Coat proposed SO materials and also recommended SO materials. Right, okay, see. And then we can use these results. So what we could do with our results, we can use these results as a marketing tool for policymakers, stakeholders, such as pipe manufacturers or as geothermal component manufacturers and environmental agencies. So these study results can be used, right. And then finally, I would like to mention that because we are, our intention is to be demonstrate the environmental footprints for the adoption of the Geo-Coat technology, right? That's why we considering considering a Icelandic perspective power plant. So we considering a specific power plant, what we call a 303 megawatt Helishide power plant. So we only consider the physical sizes of these components, what we have considered the components from this plant. So these components I will mention later. So these are the pipes and oil casings and turbine components. And we are not using any materials used in that plant, have not been considered here. Right. And then talk about the life cycle assessment method or approaches. You can say that how do we evaluate the environmental footprints of a product system? And then we have to be understand this one. So there is a method, there is a standard method, and also recognized right method, what we call the life cycle assessment method. And there are several methods existing but we consider here as the ISO LCS standard method, right? So we follow ISO, you know, that 14044-2006 standard method and also ILCD, right, guidelines. And then we need to be understand what is an LCOE actually, what LCOE does actually, what the so mainly LCOE is a method, what we, which can which can provide the holistic approach to evaluate the environmental performance, right? By considering the potential impacts from all stages of manufacturing, from the raw material extraction to the production stage and use phase and end of life stage. There are various frameworks existing, what I mentioned before, LCOE frameworks, what I mean, but primary and globally accepted method, what we call ISO LCOE standard, what we have followed here. So what is a ISO LCOE standard? What do you mean by, so that's why you have to be understand this method a little bit. I'll just take this one here, right? And then, so these are the framework of this LCOE is what we followed, right? The ISO LCOE standard. So we have to be follow the four stages. First stage is about the, so our intention is to be, our objective of the study is to be study the LCOE of a product, right? So product is the Geo-Coat technology components or SO material, right? So that's why we have to be defining our goal and scope of the study. So here actually we are comparing the studies of the Geo-Coat technology, what is the environmental impact of the Geo-Coat technology components and what is the environmental impacts of the SO materials. So that's why we have to be define the goal and scope, and then inventory analysis. It is a very time consuming, right, phase. And then third is the impact assessment. What we have generated from the inventory from the product system. So we have to be analyze. I mean, we have to be translate this input output results from, data, what we have inventoried for a particular component. And then we apply some impact assessment methodology to translate the result in terms of generate environmental impacts. And then we interpret the results. So this is, we have to be follow the four stages in the ISO LCOE standard method. And then we use a tool because we need a LCOE software tool to perform a LCOE studies following a ISO standard guideline. And this LCOE tool, what I mean that the name of the LCOE tool we are using, we used here is a CIMA Pro. So this is the first starting phase of this one. And this CIMA Pro True inbuilt is a EcoInvent database where we invented the data for different materials, different processes. And also it also inbuilt in some impact assessment methods, what I mentioned before. So this impact assessment method translate our inventory data into impact, different impact categories to understand what would be the environmental footprints of these products, right? So study design parameters, we have to be understand the how we can perform a LCOE study using a tool. So we have to be define our product, right, according to the study design parameters. First, we have to be define the functional unit. Then we have to be define the goal and scope. Then we have to be find, get the data inventory for that products, right? How that product has been made and what are the material composed of, what are the processes involved, and what are the energy flow, mass flow, we have to be inventoried in terms of a functional unit. So, and then we apply impact assessment methodology to translate our results of, and then we finally, so first we have to be defining, because we are, our goal is to be find out the environmental footprint of Geo-Coat technology components adopted in a geothermal power plant. So we know that, so different geothermal power plant has a different capacity. So that's why we consider functional unit should be 1 megawatt installed capacity of the geothermal power plant. This is one of the studies design parameters. So we have to be define it. So, and then we have to be define the goal and scope of this study. So the goal of the study is to be comparing the environmental footprints with the adoption of the Geo-Coat technology, and SO materials for the components of the plant of 1 megawatt installed capacity. What I mentioned before, this is the functional unit. So in terms of this one, we have to be defining this goal of this study. And then I have already mentioned this study results can be used as a marketing tool for policymakers and geothermal component makers and environmental agencies. And scope of the study. So here we only performed cradle to gate LCA studies. What do you mean by cradle to gate LCA studies? From the raw material extraction to the production stage. So we are not considering any operating phase and decommissioning phase for this LCA studies. We just intend to see what would be the environmental impact for producing that product, right? Right. So this is our scope of study, what I mentioned here. And then data inventories. So lots of data inventories done here. Geo-Coat proposed SO materials data inventories. So recommended state of art material data inventories, and then Geo-Coat materials. So you know that there are two different SO materials I mentioned here. One is in the Geo-Coat project, we proposed some SO materials. I considered this one. And also from the literature, we found some recommended SO materials for different components. So those can sustain highly corrosive geothermal environment. And also Geo-Coat materials, what we have developed, the different types of coating materials we are developing, right? So that's why we have to be inventory data for these Geo-Coat materials, what we have used here. And also not only Geo-Coat materials, so we have to be deposit these Geo-Coat materials onto the substrate surface. So we need to know the details about the substrate surface preparations, and also we need to know the details about the coating deposition process. So this is all this data inventories we have done, and then we generate. If you look at this table, right? So we considered four different geothermal components: pipes, turbine rotors, turbine blades, and oil casings in the first column. And we have the this is the Geo-Coat proposed SO materials mentioned here. And this is the Geo-Coat substrate materials. This is the Geo-Coat coating we have developed. And this is the best Geo-Coat coating we have for different application areas. So this is the laser cladded, what we mean by LMD, high entropy alloy 2 coating material. And you know that this is what I call, this is my Geo-Coat technology components or best candidate Geo-Coat technology components for pipes, for turbine rotors, for turbine blades, and for oil casings, right? And then you can see there is a recommended SO materials, right? So instead of using existing materials, you can use the highly resistant corrosion material, 630 SS material, or these materials, or titanium materials, right, for different components. This is the recommended SO materials, and it is extracted from the different literatures. And then we move on to the third phase of the LCA method, what we call the impact assessment. So what the impact assessment means, actually, it means that the inputs and outputs, what we have inventoried for different stages of the product manufacturing, right? So we have to know that we are collecting this data from the primary source, from the secondary source estimated, and also from the EcoInvent database system. And all these elementary data, what we have converting all this data into a functional unit. So for example, so are translated into impact indicator results. What our end goal is, to be see the environmental impact. So that's why this data values should be translated into impact indicator results by using impact assessment methodology. What we have used here, impact 2002 plus version 2.14. And this methodology generate the four endpoint damage categories. What do you mean by endpoint damage category? This is what we want to be protect, areas of protections. You know that, so we want to be save the planet Earth, actually. So we don't want to be for the production of our products, so it can increasing the global warming, so it can increasing the climate change. So that's why, so this impact assessment methodology can translate the results from the data inventory to the different categories. What I mean, the which areas we want to be protect. Climate change want to be protected. So that's why this is the one area. Another area may be human health. Another area is ecosystem quality. So from this methodology, we can found the, and this is what we call the environmental footprints, different categories of the environmental footprints, climate change, human health, ecosystem quality, and resources. So we will focus on only later, maybe on climate change. And then we can see what can analyze the results. So third section is about how we can proceed, perform a LCA result. So first we have to be defining the SO materials, right? So we have to be, defining in the modeling of the 1 kilogram of SO materials, right? It could be our proposed Geo-Coat SO material. It could be our recommended SO material, right? So what we have considered here, right? P265 and then A470, and then these are proposed SO materials, and also 304L for different components, geothermal components, what I mentioned before, and then 630SS and titanium alloys are for and also A474 recommended SO materials. So we have to be a modeling this one for 1 kilogram of this one. So what is the constituent of this material? So we have to be inventoried all this data from the EcoInvent database. And also you have to be defining the substrate materials, where we are putting the Geo-Coat coating onto the substrate. This is also we have inventoried for 1 kilogram of substance. And then we have to be considered the Geo-Coat coating, what we have developed, laser cladding high entropy layer 2. We have to be inventoried the data for this one for 1 micron thick over 1 meter square area. And then we evaluated the environmental footprints of this one, of all of this one for unit mass or for unit volume of the coating, right? So, and then we have some results here, quantification of the LCI results after using the LCIA methodology, what I mean the impact assessment methodology, and what we have found here. So in 4 different categories, what we call the environmental footprints for different materials, you can see clearly. So in the first, these columns are is about all the SO materials, and this is all about your Geo-Coat substrate materials where this laser cladded high entropy layer coating will be deposited. If you're combining these two together, then you can see that this could be maybe less than what is a highly recommended material. We'll see what impact we can have. So you can see that there is a climate change. If you look, 1.64 is the environmental impact. I mean that 1.64 kilogram CO2 equivalent can be generated for 1 kilogram of this material has been developed, right? And similarly, 5.93. So if you and then this is what we have found running the LCA tool after giving some inventory data into the system and applying some methodology. So these are the results, right? And then move on to the results. Using these results for adoption of the Geo-Coat technology components, let's see how we can invent data for geothermal components employed in the Icelandic 303 megawatt Hellisheiði power plant. So we have considered the functional unit, which is 1 megawatt installed capacity. So we have inventoried from this power plant. We know that these are the, there are 7 turbine and there are 44 well casing and 49.5 kilometer length of pipes of different dimensions, different, that length, right? So we inventoried all this data from the Hellisheiði power plant. And then we generated the functional mass flow for the Geo-Coat proposed material, recommended material, and then geocode substrate material, and then how much coating we should require for this length of pipes, right? So we have to be calculating all this invented data and generating a functional mass flows, right, for different categories. And then using this mass flows and then material compositions and other things, and we generated the results. So focus on these results. So for example, what we have found here. So if you focus on the climate change results, because I'm running out, right? So there are three different category what we are doing here. I mean, three category means LCS studies of the best geocode technology components, LCS studies of the geocode proposed SO materials, and LCS studies of the recommended SO materials. So if we focus on one of the PMS categories, what we call climate change, then you can see that we considered which one is given the worst environmental footprint. We considered this one is 100%. This is our reference. And then what we have found with respect to this one, we have found that what we have developed geocode technology, this is the most dark green, this one, dark green, this one. And we have seen that there is about 25%, I mean that 75% reduction of the climate change we can have, and also about 75% of the resources we can save. So and in all other aspects, you know, that human health and ecosystem, you can generate a lower environmental footprints as compared with the recommended SO materials once we have applied geocode technology components, right? I think, and then we can generate the results in a different way, because you know that the environmental footprints, different environmental footprints has different units, right? You know that climate change units is a kilogram CO2 equivalent. You know that lots of CO2 emissions are occurring, not only CO2 greenhouse gases are occurring. So we are considering the CO2 equivalent, considering all the greenhouse gases during the production, during the production of the materials, or during the extraction phase of the materials, right? So we have a different different units for the human health. So we converted all the units in a common single score unit, what we call the point. So that's why we are demonstrating the another way we just representing the same value, three different system we are studying for LCA, and the values of impact categories, what we have found in a different units, converted to a common single score. This is what we have presented here. Here also you can see the similar, right? Exactly the identical results in a different views. All right, I have to be right. And then quantifications of, so what we have found, if I look at the, not look at the graphs, but look at the quantified values of the environmental footprints, then you can have these values. And then we can finding out, so these are the, our geocode technology components applications results, and these are the recommended results. And if you finding out so how much environmental footprints we are savings, whether it is a positive impact or negative impact, so you can see the result. If you're using geocode proposed SO materials, it gives us the negative impact. And if you replacing the recommended SO materials by geocode technology, then we can have not a very large positive impact in respect of the climate change and the resources mainly. And that indicated that, and these results can be, because we, so geocode project results can be used to you know that this geocode technology can be used for deep geothermal development, or in future geothermal power development or EGS system development, where we can demonstrate that okay, instead of using the recommended SO material, which could be used for a very very aggressive and corrosive geofluid resources, so that can generate that our geocore technology components can sustain in that corrosive and geothermal environment, and which can replacing the recommended SO materials. And also not only we are saving the cost of the plant, also we are saving the environmental impact, right? When you are developing, applying the Geo-Coat technology in future geothermal power plant. This is so that's why you can see that about 75%, 76% reductions of the CO2 emissions, right? We can have. And then finally, we can conclude our results. So for the adoption of the best candidate Geo-Coat technology, alternative to recommended SO materials for pipes, turbine components, and oil casing, what we have considered here, employed in a geothermal power plant, in a future geothermal power plant, I would say that, and showed about 76% of carbon footprint savings. That means that about 326 ton CO2 equivalent per megawatt installed capacity of the plant. This is, and also this study reveals that the adoption of the best candidate of this Geo-Coat technology instead of recommended SO materials for geothermal components employed in future geothermal power systems of different power technology options would be sustainable with much lower environmental footprints. So I should stop here. Thank you very much for attention. Any question, please?
Thank you, Hoi, for your presentation. Guessing we'll give a couple of more minutes for people to ask questions. And in the meantime, we can move on to the next presentation from Ashadul. So from environmental footprint to economic impact of Geo-Coat in highly corrosive geothermal environment. So we have Ashadul from TBS who will be presenting on the economic impact. So Ashadul, can you please share your screen?
Hi, you need to stop sharing.
Okay, right. Thank you. Is it okay?
Yep. Good morning, everybody. With any new technology, we need to know the economic impact always. That is, what is the cost-benefit analysis of this technology, simply economic impact. So to that end, we performed geocode economic impact analysis for highly corrosive geothermal environment. I'm an electrical and electronic engineer by training. I worked in different technology segments from industrial control system, wave munitions and fraud management, telecommunications, information technology, et cetera, et cetera. I've been working with TBS since 2000, and I'm involved in several H2022 projects. This is the plan for the session. First, we'll have a short intro as to why technologies like Geo-Coat is necessary. Then we'll go into how Geo-Coat answers that question. Then we'll dig into the technology economic assessment methodology that we used. Finally, we'll discuss our findings and summarize it. One of the challenges faced by geothermal industry is highly corrosive geofluid, which makes plant component vulnerable to corrosion emission scaling. This results in periodic replacement of pipe components, plant components, such as pipes, heat exchangers, etc. In some cases, actually, we can use the traditional as a substrate at all. We have to use higher grade costly materials, and that makes actually geothermal prospect uneconomical. To that end, if we can develop a system that uses low-cost material, then we can make those currently highly uneconomical prospects economical. How can we do that? As we know, coating is playing a important role in different segments, right? If you can combine this coating with a local substrate, then those currently uneconomical or the currently highly costly power plants become cost competitive. I'll go with the introduction again. You have seen it have several times. We have developed several coatings, okay, and we have ranked them based on our laboratory skill testing results, in-situ testing results, cost performance, etc. This is the mutually ranked geocoat systems. I'm not going into detail because several presenters have already gone into details. Okay. Economy assessment is obviously an essential step in determining geocoat sustainability. We have used LCOE methodology for the economic assessment. LCOE, as the formula shows, LCOE is the ratio between all discounted cost over lifetime divided by discounted sum of energy production. And LCOE is being used to compare different technologies, new technologies in a consistent basis, or different power plants. For example, geothermal versus coal-fired or nuclear, etc. For Geo-Coat, we have developed our own LCOE calculator because commercial current calculators doesn't do what we need it to do. But we haven't done it from scratch. We have done it through from ideas of GTM and Geofires. Both of them are developed in the USA. What we did is for our geocoat calculator is we have incorporated LCOH model, defined levelized cost models, etc., etc., and of course OEM cost models. These are the costs considered for the LCOE. On the top level, we can see that we have considered exploration cost, then drilling cost, that means oil field development cost, field gathering system cost, that is pipes, surface equipment, etc., and power plant cost. Economic parameters and permitting permits are actually country dependent. Each country has its own parameters. This slide shows the default values we used for the study, for all our case studies, or representative case study. Why I will go into it later. For input data, we have developed two hypothetical geothermal power plants because partner sites at Iceland or Romania doesn't have aggressive enough geofluid for geocoat application. We have used their component dimensions, oil depths, etc. But we replaced the substrate. We replaced the substrate with the substrate recommended for highly aggressive geothermal environment. This is done through literature review. We have used the number of wells as our basis for LCOE calculation. For ease of calculation, we have assumed that production and injection wells are identical in terms of depth, PC configuration, flow rate, temperature, et cetera. We've also assumed that resource temperature declines with time and the decline is excessive. We will perform makeup drilling. We have considered only new geothermal plants for this assessment. As we don't, at the beginning, we don't know whether a prospect is viable or not, right? So we need exploratory drilling, right? Exploratory drilling, exploratory has two stages, a seam well, small diameter hole, and then after small diameter hole result is promising, then we drill full sized well to verify commercial potential. Also, we have been considered that the exploration cost is a function of the project. That is, doesn't matter how big the small or small the project is, exploration cost is same. And also default cost, exploration cost, we have taken is that for the one that is in a successful site. Of course, not every exploration activity will be successful. Some will fail, some will be successful. We've only considered the successful for the cost of the successful sites. Drilling cost is estimated from historical data. And it's based upon drilling depth. All wells have same cost regardless of whether they are successful or not. We've also assumed that 3 out of 4 wells drilled will be successful. But what we have considered is actually unsuccessful production wells will be used for injection. That will reduce the number of wells we need to drill and hence drilling cost. After drilling, we have to connect this wells to the power plant. So this means surface geofluid gathering system cost. This involves pump, pipes, etc. And of course, this is dependent on the number of wells. Power plant, there are two types of power plants, actually binary and flush. Binary power plant cost is based on second level efficiency. Equipment cost is estimated from the second level efficiency. Binary power plant cost based on second level efficiency. Higher the if there is a relationship between efficiency and cost. You increase the efficiency, you also increase power plant cost. So there is always a trade-off between cost and efficiency to get the minimum LCOE. But we can perform this optimization for our, because we are comparing current geothermal technology with Geo-Coat, right? So we can perform this trade-off. What we have done is we have performed this once for current technologies, and then for Geo-Coat technology, we kept the cost parameters same. First, flush power plant cost are estimated on flush pressure determined with built-in model. We also didn't consider transmission line because geothermal plants are in general in remote locations. And of course, transmission line cost will vary from plant to plant. But as Geo-Coat will have no impact on this cost, transmission less cost, we haven't considered it at all. We have considered the transmission line cost is zero. We have considered other costs such as indirect cost for planning, management, etc., and O&M cost. O&M costs are in general a certain percentage of the capex, and it's for yearly O&M cost. But what happens with Geo-Coat, we expect a component lifetime will increase, right? Because we are applying coating. As component lifetime increases, actually we don't need to replace these components as often. So we have a model that considers this that component will not be replaced as often. Then comes component cost, geocoded component cost. We have to calculate it somehow. Corrosion resistant coating has corrodes, right? So we will have considered that coating thickness will be such that it lasts plant lifetime. And as for the SOS substrates, we have considered substrates that are recommended in literature for highly corrosive geothermal environment. And for the geocoded substrate, we consider P65GH, A470, etc. The main challenge for cost estimation is that we don't know the cost of for large scale manufacturing. The technology is not yet high enough. It's just a TRL5. We'll go when we reach TRL9, then we'll know the cost for large scale manufacturing. So all the cost used in this study are from laboratory scale. So of course, if we consider that large scale manufacturing cost is obviously less than lab scale cost, small volume manufacturing. So LCOE, this cost will further reduce. And what we have done is actually, we have taken consider material cost, corrosion rate, coating application cost, and product cost, that is, of course, every product. Let's say you buy a product in 100 euro, right? Material won't be cost won't be the 100 euro. There is material cost, production cost, sales and marketing cost, then finally margin, right? So we have developed a model so that considers all these factors, cost and factors, to calculate geocode factor. Cost factor. And when you multiply this cost factor with the current cost, existing cost, we get geocoded component cost. These are the data we have used for this cost factor calculation. We can see from a subset material and subset cost, we already know from our project. For the material cost contribution, we have to assume actually. We have assumed that material cost contribution to the total cost is 40%. This is actually based upon my, once upon a time in my previous job, my boss said that in general, material cost contribution is total, is 40% of the total cost. We have used that one. And then we have considered that, for example, casing is all material, right? All the substrate material we are considering. But for complex components such as turbine, all total material is not the turbine rotor. There are different components, turbine, rotor, blades, etc., etc. So these are the cost factors we have considered in this calculation. And this is the simple formulas we have used for cost factor calculation. We have considered the substrate volume, and then geocode substrate cost rate, coated surface area, substrate preparation cost, coating thickness cost, etc., to calculate overall cost factor. That's used for geocode component cost estimation. In this study, we have performed LCOE analysis for two representative scenarios, one from Icelandic perspective and another from Romanian perspective. We have used component dimensions, well depth, resource temperature, etc., from literature review and on our partner site. For simplified calculation, as we have says, I have said previously, that all geothermal wells, either both production surface wells have same depth. So, but in reality, these wells have different depth. So we have used their average depth, and we have considered the substrate or the substrate as recommended for highly corrosive geothermal environment. Pumps and heat exchangers are not considered, because we don't have data, or in some cases they are not used. These are the cost factors that came up from this data, from the component dimensions and material cost, coating cost, etc. data. And you can see that we didn't have turbine for RPS, that is a Romanian perspective study, because Icelandic perspective study is actually a flash power plant. And in flash, geofluid enters the turbine. But Romanian perspective study, RPS, is actually binary power plant. In binary power plant, geofluid doesn't reaches the turbine. So we don't need to apply geocoat in a binary power plant. These are the results for Icelandic perspective study. We can see that LCOE reduced 86%. Why? Exploration drilling cost and drilling cost money. Oil field preparation cost reduces because coating casing cost reduces. Surface equipment cost also reduced because of pipe cost, and power plant cost reduces because of heat exchanger cost. And this is the same for Romania. However, also we can say that 55% LCOE reduction, and same thing, exploration cost, drilling cost reduces because of casing cost, surface equipment cost reduces due to pipe cost. In summary, geocode technology is developed to protect different parts of components in highly corrosive geothermal environment. Geocode technologies extend lifetime and reliability of oil casing pipes, turbine pumps, and heat exchangers. Geocode technologies enable exploitation of corrosive and aggressive geofluid. Geocode technology, as we saw previously, geocode significantly reduces LCOE in highly corrosive geothermal environment. As the cost we have used is actually for laboratory scale cost, we expect that for large scale production, LCOE will reduce even further. Another thing we can do is to reduce geocode is actually what we have considered is the whole pipe. Let's say a plant has 10-kilometer pipe. We have used geocode for the whole 10-kilometer, and we have for the whole 10-kilometer we have applied coating to last the plant lifetime. You can optimize this this will come from the our previous presenters' first calculation. If you can optimize this but where we apply, let's say where corrosion is the highest, we apply the 30 plant life thickness for plant lifetime. Where corrosion is, there is no corrosion, we don't apply geocode, we use current materials, right? If we can perform this kind of optimization in a coating application, we can reduce the LCOE even further. And as geocode actually reduces LCOE, that is plant cost, geocode will enhance growth of the geothermal industry. Thank you. Have a great week.
Thank you, Asadu, for your interesting presentation. Request to the attendees, if you have any questions, please feel free to type in the Q&A tab. And coming to the last but not the least presentation of the workshop, which is from our end users at On Power. So Colvin will be presenting the last presentation of the workshop. Colvin is a senior project manager in R&D at On Power. Over to you, Colvin. Thank you.
Thank you, Navrata, for the introduction. So my name is Kolbjörn Ragna Ragnarsdóttir and I'm a senior project manager at On Power. And today I'm going to talk to you about the benefit of using coatings in geothermal power plants from an end user perspective and the lessons learned within the project. Here at On Power, we have a vast variety of resources such as electricity, cold water, hot water, separated water, carbon dioxide, and our newest project, Carbfix. On Power is not only a renewable energy production company, we also provide district heating, electrical charging station for vehicles, and street lights for the capital of Reykjavik, of Iceland. At Hellisheiði, there is also a geopark where external companies can get access to our resources, especially the waste heat from the power station, where the aim is to waste nothing. Example of what the companies are producing, they are into food production, supplements, and so on. Hellisheiði is one of the largest geothermal power plants in the world. We have over 33 holes connected, and we do, and the power production of the company is 303 megawatts at Hellisheiði. We also, where we have connected 7 turbines, and we also have a lot of thermal capacity. But our biggest thermal capacity is our power station at Nesjavellir, which is located 30 kilometers from the capital. And it does produce a lot of electricity also, or up to 120 megawatts. But the thermal capacity of this power plant is much, much more higher. We also have a small hydropower plant. It doesn't really do much, but you know, it still have a hydropower plant. So I leave it to you if it's good or bad, but we also have it. So I want to talk to you a little bit about geothermal energy and what differentiates from Iceland to other countries. So why do we have so much heat in Iceland? The continental plates are slowly but surely pulling the country apart, making enormous powers come through the earth crust, like you can see here in the picture. But like Dagur also mentioned earlier, there is a volcano eruption happening now in Iceland, which is pretty amazing. And this picture was only taken two days ago. And you can see there's a lot of excitement here now in Iceland. And we can't really see it from the capital, but still I think there are many people just walking up to the volcano and taking it as like a tourist attraction. But Icelanders don't really mind earthquakes and volcano eruption since the environmental benefits of geothermal is so great. Here we can see the biggest environmental benefit I think we have here in Iceland is our district heating system. We used to have coal for the district heating, just heating up the spaces of our homes back in 1933. And then we moved over to geothermal district heating. And now we have a cleaner, better, and less polluted city. So I think we're happy all the way around. But what about geothermal on a global scale? Here we can see the estimated renewable energy shares of global electricity production provided by REN 21. From this image, it's clear that compared to other renewable energy sectors, such as hydropower, wind power, biopower, and solar power, geothermal power is a very small sector of the industry on a global scale, but it's growing bigger every year. You can see it is almost 0.4 or even less, because we have also other sectors involved in there. So the main bottlenecks for geothermal sector is high capex cost and of course operating cost. The geothermal energy production is also not applicable in cold geological areas worldwide. So those are the challenges that we're facing. So why are we, a power company, participating in a research project such as Geo-Coat? The cost of building and operating geothermal power plants can be relatively high. To make such energy production viable, it is therefore important to reduce both capex and opex cost. Using solutions that lead to reduction in downtime and less need for repair is therefore extremely attractive. Being able to reduce the overall carbon footprint has been quickly become a goal for virtually everyone. And through Geo-Coat, this made possible for geothermal power production to use less carbon intensive materials and additionally less need for shipping of spare parts, as it could increase the lifetime and durability of component with coatings developed within the project. Environmental impact is also important to us. We are devoted to finding ways to reduce our carbon footprint and presently doing so through projects such as CarbFix, which started as a research project, but it's now its own growing company. Within the CarbFix project, they extract the CO2 from the atmosphere and pump it back into the ground where it makes rock foundations, rock formations. And this is a really interesting project and I recommend you look into it. Supporting innovation and sharing information is key to creating a better future. We are participating in Geo-Coat to hopefully increase the viability of geothermal power production in world and subsequently all over the application of green energy worldwide. But how can these issues be solved? It is easy. Well, it's maybe that not that easy, but basically we identify the bottlenecks and then come up with a plan to eliminate them. The problems is, however, being able to identify the real problems and then of course how we intend on solving them. In research projects, it's extremely beneficial to include the end user from the beginning, as they can assist in identifying what the real issues are and are more business oriented. They are therefore often more in tune with what the industry needs and is calling for. And I think that the goal with everything is to reach TRL9 and make the research and the project that we're making market ready. I don't think everybody goes into research and doesn't have the striving of making their product reach the final line and make it into production and make it market ready. Then it has to be more business oriented from the beginning. There are numerous factors needed to achieve this. Some important ones are, of course, cooperation of academia, research institutes, and also cooperation with the industry. We need pressure from and on the industry to have good environmentally friendly cost-effective solutions, because it has to be cost-effective. And then of course, we finally come to the most important one, funding. The funding can be internal funding from the power companies or any companies that are working within the project, but we also can come external funding like we have here in Geo-Coat when the funding comes from the European Commission. So thank you for that. So what have we learned from the Geo-Coat project, especially from the endpoint view? A clear definition of problems and required output is important. At the beginning of the project, key performance indicator or so-called KPIs were defined. They were used to determine the requirements each material would have to be filled to be successful. Choosing the right parameters to focus on and giving them appropriate values is therefore important to be able to narrow down the best material for each purpose. We learned that the importance of being open to questioning the validity and applicability of each criteria as a project progresses, as a viable solution might otherwise be overlooked, particularly when taking into values like binary into account. Striving to fulfill the perfect KPI or the perfect product can therefore eliminate certain promising products, as KPI does not necessarily tell the whole story. It is also important that the measurements that are being used throughout the project to be compatible, and everyone has to have the same definition. Especially when you have such a big project like this as Geo-Coat, where you have different WP leaders from different companies, from different countries, but they still all have to work within the same rules as the KPIs define them. And they also have to understand the KPIs the same way. A good example of this is that in general, we would not want to see cracks in the coding. However, if such a crack appears, we would also have to be able to determine the severity, as some of the types of cracking might be manageable and further developed through erosion. Here we can see an example of a crack in the coding. In this case, it doesn't tell the whole story. We therefore sometimes have to be willing to overlook the past KPIs and look at the bigger picture. As an end user, of course, we do not want to see cracks in coding. We would never put a coded component with a crack in it into operation. But since we're at the development stage of the project and the product, seeing issues like this is, however, not detrimental, as more research and fine tuning is needed along with more precise focus. Preliminary tests were performed on a variety of codings, which were subsequently narrowed down with their KPIs qualities in mind. To choose two coding materials per application area for laboratory and in-situ testing. The results from the laboratory and in-situ tests showed promise, particularly with regarding to LMD HEA2 coding, like Dagur presented earlier today. There are, however, still problems that need to be addressed and worked with, for instance, cracking. The coding process has to be further engineered alongside the material adjustment to eliminate manufacturing defects. The coding process also needs to be adapted to be useful on appropriate geometrics. For the final test, many similar coatings were chosen. This was despite the fact the coatings were being fine-tuned for different areas of the plant. There is a vast difference between environmental effect in a turbine versus a pipe. So using the same material in both areas might not seem the most intuitive. The Geo-Coat project managed to find promising material, but now a greater focus for each component is required to fine-tune the solution for particular areas. Over 100 different types of samples were created within Geo-Coat, and over hundreds of samples were tested. So this is a broad scope approach has given an insight into what we can and cannot work with for different components. But future projects need to be based on what we have narrowed down or focused on specific areas. We also had other aspects of the project that led to possible reduction in CAPEX and OPEX costs. Heavy simulation provides ways to identify bottlenecks and the effect of change before they occur. This can both save time, money, and make risk assessment easier. And this is something has been religiously implemented in the oil and gas industry, but is fairly new approach in the geothermal industry. This can therefore be extremely beneficial for the growth of geothermal projects, as the incentive is to reduce cost and eliminate bottlenecks before they occur. Especially if you don't have a power plant already in place and you're thinking about putting it into your area, this is something that would help you get investors and people working with you So in my opinion, this could make or break future projects. As has been described previously, the CAPEX and OPEX costs are extremely important for geothermal growth. The Geo-Coat project has the aim to create cost-effective solution that reduce emission. Preliminary LCOE and LCAA within the project has shown the potential financial and emission gain of using Geo-Coat technology. Within the Geo-Coat project, the baseline for this type of analysis was made. In my opinion, this is sort of a handbook for other geothermal sites, but of course, for each site, key values need to be adapted to be able to determine whether the coating provides value for the area. This can technically be used for any sort of coating, even material in general. So what are our next step or our future milestones? There are numerous opportunities to work within the, from the result from Geo-Coat. The base work has been established to a certain extent, but for future project, more focus is needed. For instance, where we go deeper into the engineering part of the coating process itself, it is important that the coatings and the coating processes to be compatible with the processes work for the intended geometry. This includes coating application for geothermal turbines, which is a high value for a power plant like us. Within the Geo-Coat project, we started looking into coatings of a complex turbine component, and this work needs further development. It is extremely complicated to coat such a component, and care and precision is necessary there. There is a great potential in value in being able to protect the turbine part, as damage and downtime of this component can be extremely costly. We're also looking into heat exchanger with scaling and accumulation, and even corrosion can occur. So using coatings there is also a huge benefit. Hellisheiði is the next like Icelandic deep drilling project location. Many of you probably don't know about it, but I won't go into detail with it. But these are the extreme cases where we really need to think outside the box when we are selecting material selection for components, because we are entering then superheated steam, which is different from anything we have ever seen before. So I think additionally, we just need to stay open-minded as the solution could potentially be used in other industries. We always have to think about where we're going, what we have, and what we can do. So my message throughout this presentation has been, we have to think innovative. AI is going to revolutionize many industries in the coming years, or even just the next 10 years. For example, I gave an AI engine this sentence, and it wrote an entire paragraph for me, basically autocomplete for writing, not just fixing bad grammar. And I thought it was amazing. So I basically put in, innovation is important for geothermal energy. And this is what it came up with. Solving an energy problem is a tough job. To keep up with ever-changing world, we need innovative solutions. There are a lot of obstacles on our way towards sustainable energy, but innovation is the way to solve some of these challenges. We believe innovation can change the world. That's why we invest in an agile team of people that will make geothermal energy sustainable for the future, together with you. I mean, wow, think about it. AI wrote exactly what we need to be doing. So the world is changing. Everyone has to be thinking innovative. Not just academia, research institute, everyone, or else we or our company will become obsolete. The world has never needed a more of a moonshot vision where the goal is to waste nothing and strive towards zero emission, where talented and ambitious people work tirelessly together to make that happen. All of us are at the part in history where we need to be thinking about these issues. One of our goals is to be a role model for others worldwide in a progressive and a complete use of resources. So I leave you this message. We have to keep on innovating. The benefits are huge, both economically and environmentally. Thank you. Questions?
Thank you for an interesting presentation. So we have one question for you. Have you found that you have had to revisit your KPIs during the project? Do you think that your KPIs can be applied across other geothermal sectors, example, non-volcanic?
Yes, because the KPIs were mostly just focusing on the material research part, just how we identified, just looking at how we identified cracks. Is the coating going through, you know, delamination of the coating and so on. So yeah, I think it is applicable to every geothermal site because it was mainly focused on the geothermal, on the process of the coating part.
Okay, thank you so much. Don't think so we have any more open questions at the minute. So on that note, can I ask all the speakers to please turn on their cameras? And also like to thank all the attendees for joining us today in this concluding workshop on Geo-Coat. If you have any questions, please feel free to drop us an email. For more information, please visit our website, which is geocoat.eu. And let us know if you have any questions, propositions for the Geo-Coat team. The webinar has been recorded and we will be sharing the recording plus the slides before the end of this week. So on that note, thank you again for joining us today and have a great week ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Bye.